Today, we're going to be doing something a little bit different, but not really. I recently serviced this railroad-approved Elgin B.W. Raymond pocket watch from the 1800s. This 128-year-old pocket watch is keeping really good time and will likely do so for another lifetime. But there's one really disappointing problem.
Yeah, that's not supposed to happen. This is a pocket watch sleeve adjustment tool. Pocket watch cases have a sleeve screwed into its pendant that holds the stem. It's the sleeve that grips onto the various detents turned into the stem that keep the watch in either winding mode or setting mode. A worn sleeve or stem may cause the crown to feel sloppy or worse, jump between modes unintentionally. In this case, the sleeve looks fine. I have no idea why there are so many detents in this stem, but clearly this one is worn out. I have doubts this is even the original stem, and I don't know how to even fix this. Luckily, I now have the means to make a new one. This is a Boley 8mm Geneva-style watchmaker's lathe. I purchased it back in December from a reputable online source. It looked to be in great condition and came with a variety of attachments and accessories. It came with a precision cross-slide tool rest, various step chucks for holding round objects such as movement wheels, an assortment of wire chucks, a file rest, a work rest used for sawing, various lathe dogs and chucks used for turning between centers, reamers for enlarging holes, and this guy, no idea what this guy does, please educate me in the comments, tailstock runners for repivoting and burnishing pivots, though this one seems sized for clocks, tapered tailstock attachments, various male and female centers, large gravers that appear to fit the combination slide rest, saw blades and arbor, wax chucks, the smaller one with the hole I believe holds a balance staff during that process, and this four-jaw chuck with reversible jaws. The counter shaft is something I added to the ensemble to help with speed control of a small universal motor, which will allow for lower speed work without sacrificing a lot of torque. One worry of buying a lathe secondhand is whether the headstock and tailstock actually go together. There are many Franken-lathes floating around the web. Even a tailstock of the same make and model won't be perfectly aligned with the headstock unless they are actually made together. One crude but effective way to test this is to hold a razor blade between the centers. It should be true with no deflections in any direction. I'd like to service the headstock before putting it to use because I'm not sure the last time it was done, and it's a great opportunity to inspect the cone bearings. It comes apart pretty easily after removing the dust covers and retaining ring. Looks good. The index ring appears to be in good shape as well. Now everything is wiped down with mineral spirits and re-oiled using Mobile 1 Velocite No. 6 spindle oil. After tapping it back together, I like to test it and free it up just a tad to allow it to run freer. Not too much though, as I don't want to introduce any shake. On to the motor. This 1/16th horsepower universal motor I bought separately with the hopes of it being a little more appropriate than one from a sewing machine. In combination with the countershaft, it should be satisfactory for the type of work it will see. Now let's get her cleaned up. It's possible this hasn't been used in several decades. At a minimum, I'll clean the brushes and commutators and inspect the windings for any damage. The carbon brushes are filthy, but still useful. Now that I have a lathe, I needed to consider where I was going to put it. I don't exactly have a ton of space available, so I decided to build myself a small Murphy desk. This desk provides me with a decent work area, and has the added benefit of being able to store supplies and other related materials, including one of the best lathe techs ever produced. This maple cutting board will make a great base for my setup. The polyurethane belting is cut to size, and then completed by melting the ends together. This is done for both the motor and the headstock pulleys. I purchased a few of these carbide graver blanks from an eBay shop in the UK. I'll be using this Crocker-style graver sharpener to grind it down to a perfect diamond shape. Hopefully these diamond grit sharpening cards will make quick work of it.
1 hour later.
With all the setup out of the way, we can finally get to that stem. After some practice, the blued steel was very easy to turn with the carbide graver. Filing the winding square is achieved using this file rest, and the index plate can be configured in 90 degree increments to make things easier. Finally, what will become the crown section of the stem is turned down to size before it is threaded with the screw plate. Much better.
I hope you learned something from this video today, and if not, I hope you at least found it entertaining. Thanks for fixing watches with me today, and I'll see you in the next one.